Let us turn to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 17 to 31. And as he was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, all these I have obeyed from my youth." And Jesus, looking upon him, loved him and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go. Sell what you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." At that saying, his countenance fell, and he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. And Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of heaven." And the disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said to them, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sister or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel, who will not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come eternal life. But many that are first will be last, and the last first." This is the reading of the word. Thanks be to God. So like I told the kids, and this isn't even a full-size camel. I mean, this is like, I don't even know, baby-sized camel, maybe? It is easier, though, for a rich man. No. It's not. We saw the reaction of the rich man. His thing was, "It's too hard, too difficult, too much, Lord, for you to be asking me to do that." I mean, honestly. Can't you picture his reaction? "Lord, I have worked hard. I haven't killed anyone. I haven't committed adultery. I don't steal things because I've got enough of my own. Thank you very much. I don't tell lies. I'm not going to tell something or defraud something. I honor my father and mother." Isn't that enough? And yet Jesus looks at him and says, "Well, that's good. I'm glad you kept the commandments. I'm so proud of you. One more thing. Take everything you have and give it away." How many of you have moved recently? How many of you even dread the thought of that? I mean, I know last year when we were going through getting ready for the garage sale, what is it? No, not yard sale. You know what I'm talking about. How many of us were so excited because we got rid of stuff? And then you looked around and you realized, wait, I got rid of like all this stuff and I still have absolutely no room. Of this man. Many of us in here are faithful, faithful people. Not only do we come to church on Sunday, we talk to God on Monday, we might sing in the choir on Wednesday and go to lunch bunch. Oh wait, it's Sundays now, not Thursdays. We are faithful people, and yet I think we might have the same reaction. In 1985, a wonderful thing happened. Besides my birth, a new invention came to be and was made available in households nationwide. Anyone know what it was? The wonderful thing called a microwave. I'm pretty sure we have one of the original ones upstairs if you want to look at it. But man, oh man, how the microwave changed our reality. From dinners cooked on the stove to those wonderful cellophane wrapped plastic packaged TV dinners that could come with like everything from a baked brownie, like, I mean, right? You could go for those things. Or if you're in college, that's all I eat. The microwave, though, changed our reality because it soon became, instead of a thing just to reheat leftovers, it became the way of cooking. And then we went from a regular oven to a convection oven because it cooked faster. You even had to take it down 25 degrees if you were baking or doing whatever so that way you didn't overbake for the same length of time. We have those handy dandy little toaster oven things that like cook. You know what I'm talking about. They cook things fast. You can go down aisles of prepackaged, wonderful food that takes half the time. It might not taste quite as good, but when you weigh cost and measures, you can go, okay, I can take a little bad taste for the fact that I can do it in half the time or less. You see, that's what this rich man wanted. He wanted the easy, fast, two-minute, bam, and it's done with that beautiful ding answer. Don't we all? And yet, Christ looks around and says how hard it will be. We're not camels. But we are certainly rich people. We certainly have things that we can give up. We might live fairly simply in the scheme of today's world and society. So maybe it's not possessions we need to give up, but other things. Things like laziness, procrastination. Ooh, man, that's a big one. Things like, well, but somebody else can do it. I don't know quite how to phrase that one, but you know what I'm saying. But isn't that somebody else's job? See, it is hard to get to heaven. That's what Christ is saying. It is not easy. There is no easy route. It is a difficult commitment of our lives. We can't just abide by the rules. Because so many of us know those rules are meant to be broken or bent or twisted to our own understanding. So what and how do we today do this? I mean, a modern way of looking at it, it's really hard to get my minivan through the eye of the needle because that's how they travel. Right? They travel via camel. Could you picture putting my minivan through the needle? The eye of the needle? It is difficult to get to heaven. So then it begs the question of why do we even try? I used to wonder, You see, we've grown up knowing these laws, these commandments, the most basic understandings of faith. Many of us have grown up living in them, and so we do not know anything different. And yet we still struggle to be faithful people. Sometimes I want to toss it all away, right? Sometimes it would feel really, really good just to say, well, I need to step back, say no, just say no to God. Have any of us ever tried it? Oh, you don't get far. Because for some strange reason, not only are we called as people to act in one way towards God, but let me tell you, my friends, God calls us because God also wants to be that way with us. You see, not only does God have that expectation of relationship from us, God gives that expectation of relationship to us. If it's not how, if it's not what, if it's not when, it's who. See, the disciples were blessed to know Christ, and yet we don't in the same way. No matter how many times you can give a physical representation of the power of God and the power of faith and the power of belief, at some point you just have to close your eyes and take a leap. Take that step. Take that moment, that passion, that whatever it is that calls you, and do it. Because if you are not passionate, if you are not 110% invested as Christ is calling this rich man to be, then you will never truly be in faithful living. You see, he could have said something else. He could have said, you must take all that you have and hold on tight to it. That would have been easy. But he didn't. He said, you need to give it away. And the reaction was, oh my goodness, you're asking just one thing too much. So it comes down to, what is our one thing too much? We like our faith to be comfortable. That's why we've got cushions on these hard, rough pews. We need back ones. I will say that. We like to be comfortable. We like our little ruts. We like to know when you go to the grocery store that you can find bread in the same aisle for the same price, and if you happen to get a coupon, it's like a bonus. We like to know. We like our faith to be, I go to church on Sunday morning. I hear a good, semi-good message. I sing the songs I like. I do the things I like. And then I go and I do how I worship. The key word there, my friends, is I. See, that's the crux of what Christ is calling out with this young man. He is saying, you are not focused on how all of those things come to know and understand God. You are focused on how all of those things affect you. And so many of us can say the same. we've done things all of our lives. And yet the minute we have or have been called to step out, to challenge ourselves as a body or a faithful person or as people of faith united, we go, ooh, hold on. Don't rock that boat. This is not the first time Christ says, give it all up and follow me. That's when he calls each of his disciples to those 12 that follow. And we only really hear about the 12 or a couple of others here and there. We don't quite understand in our perspective that Christ literally had hundreds of people give up everything and follow him all over. Who do you think he preached to all this time in a Sermon on the Mount of thousands of people? The hundreds whom he fed with fishes and loaves. The ones he spoke to from the boat. The ones who he came to know and love. Though he only chose a few to truly delve into and teach and give his all to. Let him deny himself and follow me. I think as a church and as individuals, our response is sometimes, yes, Lord, we'll step out in faith. And we're saying it. And we might be okay with it. And yet I think in the still small voice in the back of our minds, we're going, ooh, this is too hard. This is too difficult. This is too much. How we quiet that voice is up to each one of us. We know our personal limits. We know our personal comfort zone. And yet Christ is calling each of us to come together and gather together as individuals and as a body. Because sometimes, you know what? Faith is not always an individual deal. The power of the church, the power of the body is that we're not alone. What one cannot do, two can do. What two cannot do, three. What three cannot, four. And it goes on and on and on. Christ only called 12, and yet here we are. We number way more than 12. Fortunately. Sometimes we are called by Christ to quiet that voice and say, no, 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 it is not too hard. It is not too much, and it is not too difficult for us to step out and say, Christ, you take it, you lead it, I will roll. Here we go. The challenge of our faith is to do so, to step out, to believe that this big old camel can make it in the eye of a needle. Because our God's possibility is greater than our human understanding can make it. We are either the rich young man who walks away, or the one who steps out in faith. Amen.